This is my Rupert Brooke moment. It's coming up to St. George's Day, 23rd of April, so I'd like to put out my flag, the cross of St. George, to commemorate this day. St. George is the patron saint of England, as well as other countries like Spain, Portugal, and Bulgaria. So curiously, in Zagreb, there are two statues to St. George. I have a strong affinity to England and the English landscape, and which inspired my painting for many years. And I was always interested in the artists at the beginning of the 20th century. So I try and read what I can about them. And when I was last in England, I came across this wonderful book by an authoress I'd never heard of before, called Alexandra Harris. In it, she writes about some of my most admired artists, like Paul Nash, John Piper, Stanley Spencer, Vanessa Bell, and Duncan Grant. She looks at their work and the writings of that period and explores what it meant for them to be alive in the 20s, 30s, and 40s. It was a time of a modern English Renaissance when many artists, cut off from any of the creative developments going on in Europe, many of these artists looked to their own immediate environment for inspiration. This mood was undoubtedly influenced by the threat of war and then the anxiety that people felt when it arrived. There seemed to be at the time a prevailing atmosphere to find a sense of place, a genius loci as it's called, and explore a close observation of one's immediate environment and what that could offer. I always like to quote Thomas Hardy at this point, who said,
"I believe it is better to know a little of the world very well than a lot of the world very little." And that has always been my philosophy.
And there's one chapter here which spoke to me directly. It's chapter 8, called Village Life. I made some notes on it. And I said before how I imagined this village, Bukovlje, resembled the village of England 50, 60, 70 years ago.
When I compare the situation in England with here, much of what we know in England is already consigned to history, to the history books, to the oral tradition, to museums. I mean, I would never imagine in England that I could film a man ploughing with two horses and a plough, a real plough. And that was a fantastic opportunity to record that.
And this chapter beautifully illustrates many of the points that I've been making. There was a great resurgence to record English cultural life in painting, poetry, music, and film. And the British Council made a whole series of short documentary films to help bring about a greater understanding between rural and town. And as I watch these films, I see parallels with this village to that of England of that time.
Villages are usually located where a good supply of water is available. There are two kinds of villages. One sprawls along a road, whilst the other is compact in shape. Now, lowland country is essentially agricultural, so in all fertile areas there are many farms. Every corner of the village is a reminder of the craftsmen of a bygone age, of the architects and builders of the past. Their work has stood the test of time and mellowed with the years. The carpenters and masons built these houses of timber taken from nearby woodlands. These houses were built by Flemish craftsmen, settled in England, and introduced the weaving trade. However, the villagers once more devoted themselves wholeheartedly to agriculture. Early in the morning, the villagers go off to work on the farms. On the farms, the horse is starting his work too, for in spite of the increasing use of machines, he is still indispensable for much of the work. The cows have given their morning milk and are on their way back to the fields. But the farmer is out in the fields already, for in late summer and autumn there is the harvesting, and from dawn to dusk the machines are busy. In another field the sugar beet crop is ready. A type of plough loosens the beet, and the men lift the crops and shake them clean. When spring arrives, there is more ploughing to be done. And the rest of the new season's crops to be sown. Then, once again, the grain is ripe. So revolves the farmer's calendar, which culminates in harvest. His year will commence again with autumn ploughing. Back in the village, the craftsmen are busy attending to what might be called the farmer's equipment. Thus, these trades, unchanging with the years, keep alive a tradition of the past while serving the needs of the farmers of today. Yet the village has always been quick to use each new form of progress. These modern appliances and other manufactured goods come from the towns, and to the towns go the agricultural products. Thus, town and country are interdependent. During the centuries, the village has seen many changes, but has survived them all. The village is dependent on the land. Industry after industry changed, but the spirit of the villagers remained. Always the land was around them. Outside in the fields, night begins to fall. Tomorrow, work on the land must go on afresh, for nature has her seasons, and the seasons wait for no man.
A quote from Alexandra Harris' book here. Chapter 8 on Village Life. In the 1930s, rural England seemed to be caught on a cusp. In some areas and in some respects, not much had changed since the Middle Ages. Elsewhere, there was little left of the old ways, though they might remain in living memory. There were calls for a revival of the traditional rural community. Many of those calls came from artists who saw potential for a reinvigorated local culture based in, or at least based on, the English village. With reference to the poet T.S. Eliot, Harris continues, conceiving culture and agriculture as mutually dependent, he understood the degradation of one to be disastrous for the other. The urbanization of the ruling and literary classes was a kind of standardization that signaled the degeneration of a whole society. Farming must be renewed if English culture was to stand a chance. Oh, this is not an appeal for nostalgia, since the village, like anything, has to learn to change and adapt. Quoting Harris again, one Dorset farmer wanted folk culture to evolve, not to be embalmed as the strange relic of an urban nation. And she continues, the rural writing of the 1930s goes in search of the lost secret of country life and asks what might be productively saved from the old community. I lost the skills and crafts that many of the people engaged here, like the carpentry workshop or the blacksmith. These have gone and unlikely to return. But having skills and knowledge that connect one to the land, to the earth, can only be beneficial. After the war in 1949, a book called Life in an English Village was published. In the introduction, the publisher, Noel Carrington, made some valid points. In quoting Harris again, Carrington's main point in the essay is that in order to continue, the village must change. The mounting nostalgia that had made a false religion of the old ways had threatened to bring the village to a grinding halt. How had we come to take it as natural that a typical village should look much as it looked 100 years ago? The village as it now appeared was the result of adaptation, buildings being pulled down and new, more appropriate buildings going up. The village here also seems to be on a point of transition, with the mains water arriving and the new bridge. I'm wondering whether this village might experience a revival of its own.